Welcome. We're the Masterclass series and very excited to have Karen Hollenbach with us tonight. Hello.
And
talking about everything that we all need to know, which is about LinkedIn. And it is such a kind of that place of really, how does it work?
Very mysterious, but it's not really. It won't be after tonight.
Fantastic. I'm so excited. So I'd like to hand over to you to start telling us all about it.
Thank you. So Karen Hollenbach, and one of the things that Scarlett and I talked about in the lead up to this was just helping you unlock it for branding and networking. So I'm really focusing quite specifically on those two things tonight. And then at the end, we'll have some questions. And I know that you said you've got some specific questions for me. So fire away, and know that, you know, everyone's in a really different place with LinkedIn. So the focus is really just understanding what LinkedIn is. And I think there's a few mysteries about what it is and what it isn't, and how does it work, and how is it like social, and how is it different from social. I think there's two key opportunities, which we'll talk about, which is the branding and the networking, and then we'll go to this sort of open forum for questions. Now, I've been working with Australians for probably 5 years now on LinkedIn, and there's a real pattern that I see. And that is that there's just this huge variation in people's understanding. So I really step people through this framework that starts with understanding what LinkedIn is, and I call it the LinkedIn journey. What LinkedIn is and what LinkedIn isn't, which I think is really important. Tonight we're going to look at branding and networking, but also really like anything, whether it be a healthy eating regime or daily pelvic floor exercises or whatever it is you need to do to develop and grow as an individual and as a professional, really the magic happens with LinkedIn with daily rituals. So that is something I do explore with people. And then this concept of thought leadership. So how do you leverage this platform for thought leadership? So this is really the LinkedIn journey as I see it. And tonight we're focusing in on the branding and the networking off of this masterclass. That's what we're focusing on. All right, so when we talk about branding, what do I mean and how can that relate to LinkedIn? So the first question we all have to ask ourselves as professionals, and this goes probably beyond our role as either business people or working for organisations, as we get older especially, but certainly, you know, I've been asking myself this probably since my mid-20s, is just really, who are you? And the reason why I ask you to consider that is really using LinkedIn powerfully is about understanding your professional brand and really embracing this idea of people being able to Google you and really controlling what they can find out about you online. Now, if you're active on other platforms, potentially if someone types in your name in a Google search, your Facebook page may or may not come up. But increasingly these days, your LinkedIn profile will come up. So if you've got a really well-optimized profile, I like to think of it as your 24 hours a day, 7 days a week online ambassador. And it's the opportunity for you to really control the information that people can find out about you. So asking yourself who you are in the context of LinkedIn is really this concept of this professional or personal branding. And I remember when I first entered the workforce, it was my dear father, who you can see pictured here with me. And I think that was actually his first selfie. He's had a few more since then. But one of the great pieces of advice he gave me when I first entered the workforce a number of years ago now is that your name is your most treasured possession. So really, if you understand that concept, if you've also been given that advice by someone wise in your family or within your network, LinkedIn is that concept on steroids. And it's really just understanding that people do research you online, and so you really need to present your best professional foot forward, or put your best professional foot forward. And LinkedIn's really not your resume, and it's not social media. And I make that distinction because LinkedIn gets sort of bucketed into social media if people are using it, if professionals are using it for their business. And then if they're not and they're job hunting, it gets bucketed into being like resume. So absolutely, it can be used for your business. It can also be used to be found for a role, but it is really your professional brand and how you present your personal brand online. And so how you do that and how it's related to sort of knowing who you are is really asking yourself these two key questions. So before you spend any time on LinkedIn after tonight, I really just want you to think about these two questions. And it's really, what do you want to be known for? And who are you trying to influence? And you're nodding there. And I mean, I'm sure you have these conversations with people all the time. And I really don't ask these questions lightly. And it's interesting. I ran a workshop with a corporate quite a few weeks ago, and they just said, right, we want to run two sessions with you. The first one needs to be about our LinkedIn profiles, and the next one needs to be our content marketing plan. And about halfway through the first workshop, all these sort of professionals in the room just sort of stopped and said, Karen, we really don't know who we are. And so we really just need to spend some time thinking about, what do I want to be known for? So I'm affectionately known as the LinkedIn lady. And I really like that because it implies two things. So the first thing it implies is my LinkedIn expertise. And the second thing it implies is the way I actually navigate LinkedIn and a lot of my working relationships, professional relationships. So it's with respect, with manners. But you need to think about what you want to be known for. And the second one is, who are you trying to influence? So it's really easy and it's quite dangerous to get caught in the trap. And we all do this, of trying to compare ourselves to each other or worrying about what people think of us. And so I really want to encourage you to think about, well, if I'm going to spend time on LinkedIn, who am I actually trying to influence? So in my case, I'll use myself as an example again. I really think about the organisations that I'm trying to influence and the decision makers, the types of decision makers within those organisations. So they're normally values-based organisations. They're normally digital comms, social media managers within those organisations. Or they might be growing businesses who are starting to step online, may not use other platforms like social media, might be more conservative. And then you also need to think about those people that you've worked with for years and years. You might have a corporate background, you might not, you might be quite well connected beyond your professional domain. It's really important that you're connected to all of those people and thinking about their role in referring you and what you do. So big questions to ask yourself, but certainly something you need to consider before you write anything on your LinkedIn profile. And if you're going with that lens, it really allows you to write a powerful profile, because that's really the opportunity. So when people hear your name and they look you up, you are presenting the best version of yourself, and people get a really strong sense of who you are, what you stand for, your accomplishments, where you're currently working, access to your website, looking at your current role within your organization, some of your previous achievements, voluntary experience that you do, endorsements that other people might have given you for skills and recommendations, which is just as powerful as, say, a referee if you're applying for a job, or a client testimonial. So, you know, it's saying, don't just take my word for it. These people have publicly said that I'm able to do these things. All right. So the first opportunity is really, you know, who are you? Finding your voice and telling your story and really deciding what version of your professional self is relevant to LinkedIn. And I don't mean lie. I said, what do you mean, what version? It's a professional platform. It's not Facebook. It's not Instagram. And so when I think about how I traverse those platforms, so Instagram and Facebook, my voice is slightly different. It's still a version of me, but I'm probably more serious on LinkedIn. I'm more thought-provoking. I tend to have an opinion and stay within my area of expertise. Whereas when I play on Instagram, you might see what I've done on the weekend. When I play on Facebook, you might see me sharing a picture of the rain that's around me, because that's relevant for those platforms. So it's really considering what is relevant for these platforms. And if you're wondering, well, who's on LinkedIn, Karen? I'll talk to you about networking. So how does that resonate with you, Scarlett, in terms of, you know, the first key thing?
Look, I think absolutely LinkedIn has... it's such a different feel to the others. And I think that thing, when I go in, I am a version of myself. And it is interesting when you go, okay, what version is that? And yes. I'm a brand expert. So I totally get that you have to be clear about, you know, who are you and what's the message that you want to put out there. And sometimes I think, you know, from what you're saying here is the story and thinking about your audience, how do you kind of tell that story in a friendly manner? That was the question that came up, that is, because it is kind of the LinkedIn brand, you know, there is not your own persona in it. Hence for me, that's why I'm always promoting people to have their own .com. So you've got that. So it says who you are.
Absolutely. Yes. I agree with that. Look, I think you can put your persona in there, and I think you can inject a lot of story in your profile. It's just using the visual element. So thinking about a really good picture, using the background image, making sure you're using all the options for links. So you can attach portfolios, lots of different things to your summary. Also your current experience, you can put in projects. So, you know, you can give a version of yourself which is still, like, I'm quite playful and curious and I'm sort of not that, like, people come into my picture and say, it's very corporate. And I'm like, well, I'm not, I might deal with some corporates, but I'm a little bit left of corporate. So that's exactly why my photo is the way it is. And I have a, you know, orange beads around my neck, and someone said, oh, it's a bit bohemian. And I said, well, it's not meant to be bohemian, but it's meant to give the indication that I'm not, you know, straight and narrow. I am to that left of corporate. And so I should be. I'm offering a creative element and helping people storytell on LinkedIn. So I think there's, a lot of visual cues that you can put in your LinkedIn profile. And then I think it's what you do each day. So the daily rituals and who you choose to follow, the content that you choose to engage with, your likes and comments, and so much of what happens for me on LinkedIn happens in messaging. So I'll talk about networking and give you a sense of, okay, so my real estate is really my LinkedIn profile. It can also be a company page. If you have run your own organization, you can create a company page. It's a free feature, and you can run it like a Facebook fan page. You can attract followers and curate content from there if you want to. And that's really important because you need to treat your connections like gold. So just because you're connected with me doesn't give you permission to sell to me. But if you're following my company page, it probably gives you more permission to promote things that might be going on. So claiming your real estate could look like that profile, and there's many features within your LinkedIn profile, and your summary is a really key one to tell people who you are, what you stand for. And if people, if I'm not connected with them on LinkedIn, I do invite you to connect and to really look at the way I've written my LinkedIn profile and, like, my summary especially, and look at the way I've written my experience, because I storytell. I give you a sense of what I believe in and who I work with. And then you've got LinkedIn articles, which are part of your branding for your LinkedIn profile. So if you publish a LinkedIn article, which is different to posting an update, so you posted an update today, Scarlett, and, you know, tagged a whole lot of people in it. It's an update from, it goes into your newsfeed, but it's not attached to your profile unless people sort of click into your posts and activities, your activity and your posts. And once people have done that, after time, that will sort of disappear. But if you publish a LinkedIn article, that's an opinion piece, effectively, so people can get a sense of who you are. And often people say, oh, Karen, I can't publish a LinkedIn article. I'm not a writer. And that's your opportunity to really give people a sense of who you are and what you like when they're in a conversation with you. And I really just encourage people to write like they talk. And whenever I write, I do think about my ideal client or my avatar or the person I'm trying to influence, or I will share with people the conversations that I'm hearing at the moment, and it resonates with certain people and it doesn't resonate with others. And that's really where the magic happens. It's when people start commenting and they get a really strong sense of who you are. And I know certainly with my services that people will think about me for about 3 or 6 months. It's probably the same with clients that work with you, Scarlett. They're aware of you. They're thinking about you. They're probably reading you or watching you. So LinkedIn is simply another touch point. And so if the people that you're trying to influence on LinkedIn, you need to be active. And I'll talk now about what active means. So this is the branding. This is just an example there of my background image, and that's consistent with my website and my socials. You see the headline there under my name. So that defaults to your current role. So it's really important that you put in your key areas of focus in there. And I have actually picked up running national webinars for a peak body within the recruitment industry as a result of having Storyteller in my headline and writing 2 LinkedIn articles about storytelling. And I was approached by this peak body and she said, look, you're one of the key people I've seen on LinkedIn talking about storytelling at the moment. That's what our clients are asking for. So I do encourage you, if you're seeing things trending or if there's a particular area of expertise that you're interested in, really make sure it's in your headline and inject that story in there. And then a lot of people ask me, how do I get my organization's logo into my experience? So I've shown you there what it looks like on my LinkedIn profile, and that's really just the creation of a company page. So they're the key things for branding.
Yep.
Great. I like to think that, you know, there's a little bit of my personality in there. There's certainly Think Bespoke branding in there, and it, you know, it does pop a little bit more when you have a bit of a think about the images that you can use.
Can I ask you just one thing?
Yeah.
Just with your listing of, you've got a few things on that on the top, and I personally always think, oh, you know, and I've stripped it right back to Mrs. V at the moment, because I was like, because there's so many different things I do, and then I get up. Now you've got training specialist, storyteller, speaker, content marketing strategist. Is it of benefit to put a few things there, obviously?
Depends on your goals. So I traverse three different groups. So one of them is peak bodies that are looking for a guest speaker to talk to their members about how to leverage LinkedIn. So I need to have speaker in there, and I need to have the fact that I'm a specialist in there. And importantly, I don't write expert, because a teacher, if you go down my profile further, you'll see I'm a registered teacher and Cert 4 trainer, and I'm a lifelong learner. So people in the education sort of area are quite attracted to that. I think if I said expert, that language is not correct. Storyteller is just me being a bit playful, to be perfectly honest with you. Yeah, and it's topical at the moment. And I've had debates with journalists about what a storyteller is. Yeah. And this content marketer, it's interesting. So a competitive set that I work with, we're all sort of pitching for the same client. And he said, I'm really glad I found you. And I, oh, thank you. What is it in particular? He said, oh, no, when I looked at your profile, I really am glad that I found you. And I said, look, could you just tell me in particular what it is about my profile? And he said, look, you're a content marketer. So as a digital marketer, he could see that I had credentials that were relevant to him. And philosophically, that's how I approach engaging on LinkedIn. And I'm quite different to other people that might share some LinkedIn expertise, in that I'm less sales focused and more marketing focus. And I believe in content marketing principles. And so that was really attractive for him. And so I think the clearer the sense of who you're trying to influence, the stronger sense you have of that, the more relevant that headline is. And really, our profiles are a work in progress. So it'll be when I sort of start to see patterns in the way people are describing me or what people are looking for, that I'll always tend to use other people's language of how they describe me, because storyteller was a way someone else described me when I was invited to a guest panel. So it's not how I actually describe myself.
Yeah.
And so I just, you know, depending on what you're doing, Scarlett, too. So if you're doing different things, be ruthlessly focused for 3 months on your profile looking one way.
Yeah.
And if you're really trying to get into conversations, make sure it just is written for those people. Because once you're connected with someone, I can almost guarantee they'll never look back at the detail of your profile again. Yeah. But it's in that buyer journey when people are really researching you and working out whether you're for them. That's who you should be writing your profile for. And so many people go, oh, yes, that makes so much sense, Karen. It's like, yes.
I know, no, it's good, because it's that whole thing of, and of course, you know, it's like, what are the areas that you want to talk about, and kind of for people to say, oh, that's what I want. Because all the time people are looking for what's in their mind of what they're after.
Absolutely. And so, a big part of what Think Bespoke, so my company does, is career planning, but I don't talk about it a lot on LinkedIn, because it's Facebook and Instagram territory for me. That's where I pick up those clients. So it's really about thinking about very clear voice. So it's still me. I'll still talk about career planning on other platforms. I just won't talk about it as much on LinkedIn.
Is that interesting? All right. Sorry.
No, that's fine. Fire away. If you've got the question, other people will.
Well, the question is, just about that. You've just said, okay, so you're getting a lot more from Facebook on the career thing. So is it that the audience who's mainly on LinkedIn, you've differentiated that there? So can you just expand a little bit more on that?
Well, if I just offered, so within my business, if I just offered career planning,
yep.
I would, that's all I talk about on LinkedIn, but really it's only 15% of my business. So like profit, bottom line. So I'm looking at, when I'm on LinkedIn, to target larger organizations that are wanting a LinkedIn trainer or a guest speaker. And so,
okay.
Yeah. And so there's clues within my summary that I work in the career planning space. And every now and then I will write an article that talks about career planning, and I will like and comment on content on a sort of 4-to-1 ratio that's related to career planning. And so what happens to me with career planning is, it's clients refer me. And so I don't really need to talk about it. People sort of will see my motivating quotes on Instagram or LinkedIn, motivating quotes on Instagram or Facebook, and they'll know that's one of the things that Think Bespoke does. Wow. But this is where you have to make that separation of self versus company, and sort of go, well, who's Karen Hollenbach? And so it's just, as a branding expert, you would appreciate this. It's, you know, what is the KarenHollenbach.com concept? And I don't have my own website, but I do agree with you that your website and your list are the most important things before any of any platform. And then it's about, well, when I'm on LinkedIn, what is the biggest conversation I want to get into? Because if I'm trying to do all three, I'm not doing one well.
Look, it's hard. I mean, I have the nightmare, and also to my team, it's a nightmare because my brain never stops and I'm highly creative in the sense that I'm just always want to make things. So therefore I'll be like, oh, here's a new website, here's a new concept. And, you know, people said, oh God, I can't keep up with you because there's so much change. And for me, that when I really boil it all down, it's only been recently actually, whereas my main thing is I'm a brand expert, and that's what I work with people on. My tools are my video work and my creating websites and kind of building the making part of it. The mrsv.com.au I've literally just made, which has been a long time.
I saw it today. Yay. Yeah, it was exciting.
And it was, and I think it's taken a long time to hone into this is who I am and do that. I've got Mrs. V Society, which all my focus the last 2 years has been on, but that's really about everybody else. And that's about all the experts. It's about content. So it's taken me a long time to separate myself out of that and go, this is what I love, because I do. I love talking about people and referring people. But then when it comes to my expertise and what I do is I've really had to go, oh, by the way, these are my services. And I do, you know, personal branding and I do speaking. And, you know, being on media. So I've had to kind of draw that out. So I totally get that there's a different audience.
And it's not easy to do. And I think it's interesting to hear a branding expert say, you know, I've had to do the work too. I mean, this has been a 7-year journey for me. And I'm presenting in a conference on Wednesday morning and sort of explaining to them a whole lot of sort of ambiverts and introverts. So they tend to be, they're less extroverted by default. And I explain this concept of my journey with personal branding and how it's been a really long road to appreciate the value of imagery and the value of branding photos and the value of, you know, having to get on video and webinars and people seeing your face. And it's really scary. And so I think we just, that's the reason why I showed everyone that journey at the start, that I do believe we're all a work in progress. So if today people just get the concept of understanding where they're at, and just sort of slowly trying to find their voice. And I do get great pleasure out of helping people find their voice and tell their story. And LinkedIn is actually a really safe way to do that, because you can just really stick to your area of expertise and then you can tease out your personality slowly. Whereas I see people on Facebook and Instagram, which are amazing platforms for different reasons, that just feel very exposed. And so LinkedIn is a really it's sort of in a crazy way, quite a safe place, because you're sticking to your professional expertise and you can slowly draw out your personality.
Yeah.
It's sort of the reverse of how everyone else seems to be doing it. I speak to people often that, I've got a fabulous quote here from a client today, and she's new to, the online world. And she said, my relationship with Facebook is an arranged marriage. There's not a lot of love there. Because she just feels really, like she's being dragged to the platform, or she heard me speak, you know, you've got to be on Facebook, which is, you know, it's where everyone is. It's the number one platform. But Census did a social media report, and they lumped LinkedIn into that report for, they interviewed 800 Australians in February this year. Oh. And guess which is the number one, the number two social media platform? It's LinkedIn. 4 out of 5 Australians are on LinkedIn. Just the behaviour is different. So I'll talk to you about what that behaviour is. So I love this picture. To me, it represents what I think LinkedIn is. So, okay, Karen, if it's not social media, and it's not a resume, what is it? So it's a professional networking platform. And if you want to view, just think if you go to an event, or if you attended, you know, one of your major events that you run, and you walked into that room and you had a chat to people and you were talking about yourself and you were describing what you do or what you're passionate about or what you believe in, I just want people to imagine that LinkedIn is a virtual room, and that your LinkedIn profile is you having that conversation. And the messaging and the opportunity to like and comment is just that virtual space. And so if you can seek some comfort from that and think, oh, okay, it's more about having a conversation, then I think you're starting to unlock what LinkedIn can be for you. And, you know, it's just sort of understanding the rules of engagement. And I just hear a lot of people say, look, I'm not sure what to do. I'm worried that everyone's looking. No, they're actually not, because there's not the, even though we've got a high number of users on LinkedIn, they're not anywhere near as active as they are in other platforms. So people can spend up to 2 hours on LinkedIn in a week. And I'd argue they spend a lot more time on other platforms. I mean, people can get lost in an evening on Instagram or Facebook. All right. So what do you do when you're on LinkedIn? Okay, Karen, I understand branding and I've, you know, injected some story and I've put some great images up. Now what do I do? So really the sort of biggest mistake I see people make, and I read a blog about this recently, the three worst things you can do on LinkedIn is not have a profile photo, but one of the mistakes is just not having a connection criteria. So being a little bit cagey about who you connect with. And I just see that as being quite short-sighted, because if someone sends you an invitation to connect, it's for a reason. And I do appreciate that there's some really bad behavior on LinkedIn, but if your profile's not written well, you're going to attract the wrong type of person if you're not being really clear about what you're doing. So I do encourage connection criteria. I'll give you an example of that. People say, well, I won't connect with someone I don't know. Well, you know, why? If someone's reaching out to connect with you, they've heard your name, they're interested in you for a reason. Yes, they could be trying to sell to you, but okay, it is a professional networking platform. So it's no different to going to an event and someone, you know, why are we on this platform? So mine is that you need to be in a country I transact with. You need to have a picture and you need to maybe have a few mutual connections. So I need to have a strong sense that I could probably check you out. And once you accept the person's invitation to connect, I just have a follow-up ritual in the next week where I say, you know, thank you for the invitation to connect. How can I help? And I very quickly weed out the people who just are trying to sell me something, because they'll pretty quickly put me on an email list and will try to sell me, get me to read a chapter of their book. But that happens less and less these days. And, you know, probably 4 out of 10 of the people that send me an invitation to connect have either heard my name, read my blog, heard me guest speak, being referred by a friend. And very often they're also introverts. And so it's a really comfortable way for them to reach out. And I talk about introverts and ambiverts a lot, because I affectionately say that LinkedIn is networking for introverts. So, you know, some people might not ever go to those networking events, but gee, they're researching you online. And it's just being aware of that and understanding that the digital space is a space that some people are just a lot more comfortable with, and that's okay. That's where people have, you know, conversations. So have a connection criteria, be active. So all that means is think pelvic floor, ladies, 5 minutes a day. You know, do you have the app on your phone? Do you, you know, how much time are you spending on Facebook and Instagram? Just dedicate 5 minutes. Have a look at your phone, have a look at what's going on LinkedIn, accept invitations to connect, think about who you're following, think about, you know, influencers that you're reading, and then just choose 3 topics. So for you, Scarlett, you might say, okay, I'm going to like and comment on globally great examples of branding. Or I might talk about video, or I might talk about websites. So you just choose these 3 things and you just try to go a little bit higher. So not necessarily people in your local market, but people globally. And if you really are positioning yourself as a leader in your industry, as you are, then you need to be curating and being seen as the person that really knows what's going on in that space. So you just need to choose 3 topics. And the reason I say this is people say, oh, I don't want to publish, and I don't want to send updates. That, you know, that's fine. Just like and comment or share, you know, content that you think is really useful. So I rarely write about introverts, but Susan Cain has set up a whole quiet revolution, and she's done TED Talks and she's written books. And so she has some fabulous content that I share and people can really relate to it. And they know, it's so funny, if I get up and guest speak and talk about LinkedIn and my story with realizing I was an ambivert and had ambivert tendencies, not extrovert, I can almost guarantee you within 24 hours of saying that, an introvert will message me and say, oh, I could totally relate to what you were talking about. But they'll never walk up to me in a room because I just understand the behaviour. So choose 3 topics, and that's probably something for you to think about too, Scarlett. You know, just what are the, you know, who are the global leaders? You'd know who they are, but just curating that so people go, oh, that was a really useful article I read from or that she shared, and it made me, and it means you stay top of mind within your area of expertise. It doesn't always have to be you sharing information about you. And then profile views are absolute gold. So if people are looking at your profile, and this is unfortunately only something if you have a paid account, you can see more than five. So LinkedIn, especially with the purchase, yeah, of Microsoft purchase of LinkedIn, not a marriage. So they really do want you to spend, I think it's a minimum of $30 a month. But that to me is a huge lead generator. So people will be looking at my profile, and a weekly ritual is for me to just reach out to them and say, hi, I saw, you know, LinkedIn tells me you're looking at your profile. And I'm very easygoing, so I would just message them in that way.
Do you connect with them, really?
I say hi, you know, and I make a point of not then following up because that's really sleazy, you know.
Yeah, that's the balance. It's like, you know, you were talking about when someone wants to be your friend and you, I actually go, okay, they don't look okay, even though they mightn't have connections. But if they immediately try and sell me something, I defriend them. I'll give you the benefit, but then don't abuse it.
It's very easy to do that. And I think that's a great strategy because it's so easy to just unfollow. Like either unfollow if they're sharing guff or if they get really sleazy on you, just block them. I mean, I don't even block and report because I just think it's bad behavior. And, you know, it's like there was a beautiful analogy. I read an article a while ago now talking about, you know, why it's sleazy to be salesy on LinkedIn. And, you know, the comments in the bottom of the article where, you know, it's like trying to get into the bedroom on the first date. You know, it's just manners to, you've just got to build a relationship. It takes time. And so that's why I'm really comfortable reaching out to people looking at my profile, because I can rely on the quality content that comes from me liking, commenting and publishing LinkedIn articles and now micro stories. And you can do video updates, which is incredible. Yeah. If you're a lover of video, I'm walking slowly down the video.
I'm great at doing it for other people. I'm just starting myself to do it.
Yeah.
One of those things, oh, I look terrible today.
It's never a good day. You know, I'm a lover of the written word. So how I overcome it is webinars, and I'm doing, you know, I've got a Facebook Live plan. I'll eventually make my way over to LinkedIn. So that's sort of the key thing. And then I've just put up here, this is my website. So yes, I'm all about helping people unlock LinkedIn for their business or career, but I don't know if you can see it. They're just up near my necklace. There's the start here page. So that's a really useful resource if people have tuned in today and are thinking, I don't know where to start. I get what Karen's talking about. I relate to that sort of concept of feeling like a work in progress. Where do I find out more information? So you can click there, and I've got four portals. I've blogged since April 2013. People sort of quite facetiously and cheekily say to me, oh gee, it's cute the way you get so excited about LinkedIn. But I've written a lot on the topic. So I've got the four portals is sort of your individual LinkedIn strategy, your organizational LinkedIn strategy, mid-career planning, surprise, surprise, because that is one of the things that I do. Because I know when people are ready to launch, they want to play on LinkedIn. So that's why I play in that space. And then the fourth one is content marketing, which is this concept that it helps me attract the right type of clients, because if someone rings me and says, okay, I've got a conference or I've got a, you know, seminar in 8 weeks and I want you to help me work LinkedIn so I can get bums on seats, I'm just like, listen, mate, I am not the trainer for you. You know, that's not how I play. So Rome wasn't built in a day, and if you build, they will come. So if you really want to unlock LinkedIn, you've got to take your professional and personal brand seriously. And you just have to use it. There's heaps you can do with the free features. So, you know, you don't necessarily have to have that premium account. And I've got an online shop. If people want to sort of have a bit of a look around, there's a few downloadable tools to help you write your profile of interest. And I do say to people, if you read every single blog on my website, you would be training LinkedIn, but I do know that people don't. And so there's lots and lots of resources there. You don't have to jump on the shop, but it's there if you're interested. And then just questions. So you've asked a couple of questions. I don't know if anyone who's joining us wants to ask.
Yeah, just how regularly should you update your profile and description?
Well, I think every 6 months I'd have a bit of a look at it. So Just make sure it's representing you, especially. So it depends if you're running a business versus in a role. So if you're in a new role, I sort of talk about this concept of tending to your LinkedIn garden. So it's worth you just diarizing to take a bit of a sticky beak at your own profile every 6 months and make sure it's presenting the best version of you. I find my business morphs every 6 months. So I've sort of said yes to something. I'm a bit like you, Scarlett. I'll go, oh, that's exciting. I should do that. And then I think, oh, hang on, that information on my profile is outdated. So just have a bit of a look at it every 6 months. And if you are going to make changes to it, your LinkedIn profile is best accessed and changed from your desktop. So you can have the app on your devices. And I see a lot of people with tablets sort of go in via the app. I just think there's a lot more function. There's great functionality from the website. So just do it from your laptop or your desktop.
Oh, awesome. Okay, wonderful. I've got another question about the title of your LinkedIn. I noticed you didn't mention bespoke directly under your name. Do you recommend areas of expertise first and then company name second?
Thanks. Yeah, so the defaults, yes, I do. And the reason for that is LinkedIn will automatically have your current organization and your not necessarily most recent, where you have placed your first place that you were educated. So I'll often see people do like Life Coaching Institute and they've got an undergraduate or a postgraduate degree, and I'll say to them, look, just move your sort of undergraduate and postgraduate degree up. So it will automatically show your organization and it will automatically show the last place or the first place you've listed in terms of study. So it's wasting space putting that in your headline.
Good point. That, no, I like that. Okay, so it's really about, you're trying to catch the thing that you do, as we were discussing, for that audience, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, there's three ways you can write your headline. The one is the default, which is just your role title and the organization. That's the LinkedIn default. The second one is to be really tricky and to, so let's say you're a CPA, but you're really a management accountant. So you might call yourself so much more than a number cruncher. And if that's relevant for your ideal clients, go for it. I think from a search point of view, you're better to say, you know, these are the clear things that I do. And I also say to some clients, I have a gentleman that works as a national business development manager in the construction industry. And so he says, commercial and industrial construction, client relationship management. So people are really clear. He's not residential. He, you know, these are the areas that he operates in. This is what he does. And his pictures, he deals with architects. So his pictures very much, he looks like an architect, effectively. Yeah. He looks really approachable and lovely in his picture. And it's exactly what he's like as an individual. But, you know, as a business development, you know, national business development manager, he could get a little bit stuck by his ego and, you know, put a suit on, but it just wouldn't be relevant for his clients. So he's really thought through his photo and his background image.
Oh, great. Okay, now I get that. I think when she's saying to make sure it's not in the headline, I think
it defaults. It's already there.
Got it. Okay, awesome.
So it's a very long way for me to answer that question. Sorry.
Oh, no, it's all fantastic. I love it. Is it appropriate to use LinkedIn to get work or employment?
Oh. Absolutely. So it is first and foremost, when it was established in 2003, it is recruiters are on there daily. And so if recruiters are asking to connect with you, say yes. So often I meet people who are job hunting that, oh, so sick of recruiters, you know, or aren't job hunting. And so it's the number of recruiters that contact me. And then later on, I said, gee, don't you wish you had accepted that invitation to connect? So absolutely, you can find your job there. There's a job function. Make sure all of your skills, so you have 50 skills available to you that you can list. Mm-hmm. So recruiters will search under job title, location, and skills. And you also need to think about in your headline, if you're looking for particular work, what you should do is, if you're currently not employed, if you've chosen a redundancy or you resigned because you chose to resign or you've moved, whatever reason, you should actually, excuse me, in your current, what you're doing currently, have the title of the job that you're looking for. And have your headline as the type of job that you're looking for, and look at all the advertised jobs, in that area at the moment, and use that language. It's exactly the same concept that I was talking about. And there's also a secret button in your privacy settings that you can actually let recruiters know that you're open to being contacted.
Oh my goodness, now.
So that's LinkedIn trying to add value to one of its biggest clients, which is recruiters, that if you have a recruiter package with LinkedIn, it's $20,000 a year. So,
wow, that's big. No, that's a great point. Oh, huge benefit. Wow. Mm. Thank you.
So yeah, don't ignore it, as it's absolutely there for you to find your next job. And so many people I know got their last job on LinkedIn.
No, awesome. No, that was fantastic. Gosh. One thing I wanted to ask was, you know, because I guess the way that my mind works, I'm always thinking about what's, you know, what's out there, like what's happening and the movement and the evolution of the digital era, which we know is digital going into more in intelligence. You know, it's all about things being thought for you. So where do you see, I mean, have you got an idea or a sense of where LinkedIn's going or where we're heading on any form?
Well, they've employed a whole lot of AI, so artificial intelligence experts recently. So that was reported in TechCrunch, I think, or VentureBeat reported it in October. So that was only quite recent. So they're trying, you might have noticed a recent change in your messaging, that it's prompting you for responses. That's quite a recent thing. So that's an example of, you know, them thinking for you effectively. So I think Microsoft in the last 12 months, I've probably seen more feature changes on LinkedIn than I've seen in the sort of 2 years prior. So I think we'll definitely see more changes. I think, you know, millennials have really jumped on LinkedIn with the video feature, and I think that's changing the behavior slightly. So I think LinkedIn will become more Facebooky, and I think that's okay. Like, I think it will make people feel, even though I talk about, you know, you can, you know, position your brand and operate with authority, I think it's becoming a more accessible place because it's really active. They moved a whole lot of Facebook stuff over to LinkedIn. So they're really trying to, they're really aware of this concept that I call LinkedInitis, that people are a little bit scared of what to do when they're on there. Although I'd say that's one of, that's actually one of the things I like about it, that it, there's less guff. There's less what you had for dinner. And so I'm watching what's happening. I'm watching what's happening with interest. You know, I'm a strong believer as a content marketer in value adding content. So as long as the people I'm connected with are respecting my time and sharing with me content that's genuinely helping me move to a better place, and I think LinkedIn will maintain its integrity. And I'm also interested, you know, how long the sort of current wave of video lovers will stay on LinkedIn and whether they'll jump on to the next latest thing. So I'm not suggesting for a minute people are fickle. I just know that there is a group of people, early adopters, that like new things. So when the video feature came on board, you know, it attracted a different type of behavior. So yeah, I think you'll continue to see lots of changes. The other thing just to be aware of, I'm seeing in the sort of global LinkedIn training space, is a done for you service, which is something I'm absolutely thinking about. I'm trying to explore how to ethically do it. Next year, which is people, I've got a lot of CEOs coming to me saying, I understand I need to be on this platform, I just don't have time. And so I do ghostwrite for a number of people on LinkedIn, and I co-write their LinkedIn articles. And so I'm seeing an increasing demand for, you know, to help people manage their LinkedIn profiles. And so I think ethically we really have to look at that and be clear. I think it's an opportunity for people to choose a platform, whether it be LinkedIn or Instagram or, you know, whichever one you want to be on, and be you, like take control of it. I had this lady on Instagram who kept following me and not following me and following me and not following me and following me and not following me. And I just sent her a message and said, can you please make a decision as to whether you are following me or not? Like every other day I get this notification telling me that you're not following me.
What was the reasoning?
Well, she said, I've got automation software on my Instagram account, and if I follow someone and they don't follow back, I stop following. But obviously my account fits a certain criteria, so her bot effectively keeps following me. So it's not even her. And as soon as she did that, I just thought, wow, it's not even you. And so I think we've really got to be careful. I mean, I don't think you can live on you can survive on a digital diet alone. So if we embrace the concept of LinkedIn being a professional networking platform and we understand that it's an opportunity to continue conversations that we've had. So if you go to a networking event and you're inviting people to connect, just be you on it. So I'm happy to help you co-write. I'm happy to help, yes, you know, ghostwrite for you.
Yes.
But when you're having conversations, I'm not convinced you can outsource that.
Yes. No, I mean, that's the thing is, because I mean, obviously I get people when I do their branding and, you know, there's a whole conversation about doing social media for them and, you know what to do. I mean, I practically don't even do it for myself because, you know, it's the whole time thing. Because really, as I've been told by many well-known social billionaire marketers, it's best to focus on one and then really make that rich and strong. And of course, I've not done that for myself. I kind of go, I'll just do a little bit here because I keep that going. But it is interesting how the automation part is scary because I like that conversation of really getting a feel for things. But some people do. You have to be in the game. So I totally... Mm-hmm. I mean, some people just don't have the time. So when I work with a client, I have someone who does social media and I get them on it and they look after that, but you oversee it. So I get that. I think that's great. One of the questions she's just answered is how do you update your profile without anyone knowing you have done so?
So there's two ways. It's actually become a lot easier than it used to be. So you can actually jump into privacy settings when it's in the top right-hand side when you're on your desktop and click into privacy settings. And in privacy, you can let people know that you're making edits or not. But fortunately now, when you're in different sections making changes, LinkedIn will say, you'll see a notification down the bottom saying, you will be sharing these edits or you won't be sharing these edits. So before you've sort of said, you know, pressed save, you have that option. So no, there's really two safeguards now. And I think there's also the option, excuse me, on the phone. So, you know, just be careful, but go in sort of the safe way. But I would argue both ways are really safe now. And it's interesting because one of the things I used to do when I updated people's profile was right at the end, I wouldn't tell anyone about any of the changes. And then right at the end, I'd change it back to, yes, tell my connections that I'm making changes and I'd upload their photo. And so they'd have this brand new, you know, professional photo and everyone would comment on that, which I thought was great because it was a really good conversation starter, yeah. But you can't do that anymore. LinkedIn won't let you, you can just change your photo. It won't notify people that your photo's changed. So, so it's a lot safer than it used to be. And just back to that comment that you made about sort of automation, I think automation from a content marketing point of view is brilliant. So for social media scheduling tools, I think it's fantastic. Yeah. I think, yeah. The problem is when you bring in automation to comment on your behalf, and I have this debate with social media marketers in the sort of Facebook space, and they basically argue that if a client has briefed them really well, they feel really comfortable commenting on behalf of the client because they've been briefed on the client voice. And I think that's fine. I think when it's a company page, that's absolutely fine. But when it's the person, I think you just have to invest in either briefing someone that is, you know, either a content marketer, someone that is like a copywriter that understands your voice. I mean, most of our politicians don't write their own speeches.
No, exactly.
No, but I just do that. It properly.
And no, it's great. And it's great to know you too, because I might be going. Yeah. And it's great for everybody who's watching this and listening that you are there, that you need your LinkedIn profile audited and to work with it. Karen can do that. You do that as a service and do sessions and content writing and and speaking. So that's wonderful.
All right. So any other questions?
No, I think everybody's all good. That's fantastic.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yes. And I feel inspired because it's such a big thing and, you know, I'd love to do it again as well. And look, you can find also, just so everyone knows, Karen on Mrs. V Society. You're on the directory there as well. And hopefully in the next not too distant future, we'll be doing another event and having you on to on the panel. So that'd be great.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you. And thanks to everyone listening in and over and out from the Masterclass webinar. And have a great week. Bye.
Bye.